Okay, we'll begin. Are there questions?
So, last time when you said dark matter could not have been produced at the temperature when they were relativistic, did you assume any constraint on the mass of dark particles?
Yeah, meaning dark matter, what we assume is that dark matter particles are sufficiently heavy, right? They're non-relativistic.
But is that known?
Yeah, that is more or less known, because what one can show is that the light dark matter, right? For example, I mean, one possibility would have been neutrinos or something like neutrinos as dark matter. But that has been ruled out because it doesn't allow structure formation. I mean, for a formation of structure, one needs reasonably massive dark matter. So very light dark matter has been ruled out by experiments. By experiments meaning by knowing the known structure, one can show that very light dark matter is not enough to form structure of the kind that we see.
Okay, so structure formation as in the formation of galaxies.
That exactly.
Okay.
Right? Yeah. So from this microwave background fluctuation, we have to form structure, right? And that happens because of the small gravitational perturbation grows, right? If the gravitational potential is a little stronger in one region, it will start attracting more matter. But that detailed dynamics also depends on what kind of matter you have. If the matter remains relativistic for a long time, then it tends to not form structure. It tends to make it more uniform. So from that, there are constraints on dark matter masses, right? So we assume that dark matter mass is sufficiently heavy.
Okay. Yeah.
So what we know is that any non-relativistic matter, if it is produced, and any matter which is, if it is produced at the relativistic scale, then its mass must be sufficiently low so that at the matter radiation equality, it still remains relativistic. Right? Because if it had become non-relativistic before matter radiation equality, then it would start dominating.
Yeah.
Okay, any other question?
So could you give a like rough estimate of what people think the dark matter particle mass would be?
Typically people, there are various kinds of dark matter models, but the one that is commonly used, right, which are called weakly interacting massive particle, that particle mass is of the order of, say, 100 GeV or so, weak interaction scale. Right, and the interaction strength of the dark matter particle also people take to be of the order of weak interaction scale.
And people have estimated when it would freeze out?
Yeah, so we'll do that calculation later. Right, I mean, we can actually calculate the freeze out density in terms of the model. See, we need a particular model, right? Because it depends on the details of the interaction and so on. But given that, we'll see later how to precisely calculate the freeze out temperature and estimate the current density of dark matter in the universe. So okay. After you have gotten that result, then you have to apply it in reverse, right? Then knowing the current density of dark matter in the universe, we can constrain the parameters that govern the dark matter dynamics. Right? Because once you fix the Lagrangian that involves the dark matter particles, then everything is fixed, right? I mean, you can calculate precisely when it will freeze out, what the relic density will be, and so on. So once you have done that calculation, then you apply it in reverse, that given today's dark matter density, that puts constraint on what kind of Lagrangian it might have.
Okay.
Any other question? Okay, so let me remind you that what we have learned yesterday. So what we saw is that neutrinos decouple at a temperature of order MeV. And after this, T nu falls off inversely as power of lambda. So it's given by Tf lambda F over lambda, where F corresponds to the freeze out temperature. So at Tf and lambda F, so this is freeze out temperature. And lambda F is basically the value of lambda at freeze out. So after this, E plus E minus and gamma, these are the only light particles left. These remain in thermal equilibrium. There are, of course, also some excess protons and neutrons, but they do not affect the thermodynamics at this scale, that as we have emphasized. So we basically focus on these for now, E plus E minus and gamma. And so let's denote by T the temperature of this system. So in particular, T also measures the temperature of the photon. And whenever I use T without a subscript, it will always refer to the temperature of the photon. Okay, because that is directly related to the cosmic microwave background temperature. So you can ask, how does T evolve with time? How does T evolve? And as you have been emphasizing, it evolves by simply using S lambda cube equal to constant. As long as the system is in thermal equilibrium, we can use S lambda cube equal to constant. And this in particular can be written as SF lambda F cube equal to S lambda cube, where AF is again the value at the phase out temperature.
So,
yes, go ahead, please.
If neutrinos phase out at order of mega electron volt, then even two positrons, electron and positron going to two photons, can also, this reaction can also phase out at that time, right? Because the mass of electrons is of order of mega electron volt, right?
MeV, 0.5 MeV. So it's not, so what you are thinking of is not freezing out, but it's becoming non-relativistic. Right? Because E plus E minus interacts by electromagnetic interaction, and that's much stronger.
Okay, yeah, okay.
So basically, the 1 over mw squared that you saw there, right? So for electromagnetic interaction, the 1 over mw squared that we saw gets replaced by 1 over energy squared, okay, which is 1 over t squared. Okay, and T of course is very small, right? I mean, T is much smaller than MW at this stage. So because of this, the electromagnetic interaction doesn't freeze out very easily. When T falls much below the electron mass, this 1 over T squared will be replaced by 1 over electron mass squared. But that's still much stronger than the weak interaction scale, right? Which is 1 over MW squared.
Yeah.
So E plus E minus gamma is in thermal equilibrium, right? That's why you are using this formula.
And okay. This entropy contains the contribution from photons and electrons and positrons.
Exactly. Because that's in thermal equilibrium, right? Electrons and neutrinos have already decoupled, right? So the point is, you can include neutrino entropy in this formula, because that's conserved by, not by because of the thermal equilibrium, but simply because S goes as T cube, right? And T is falling off as 1 over lambda. So S lambda cube is constant for neutrinos, right? Not as a consequence of thermal equilibrium, but it just so happens that the thermal spectrum remains thermal.
Okay, yeah.
So here you could add the neutrino contribution, but it's not necessary, right? So this S here contains only the E plus E minus gamma contribution. Is this okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now we are going to apply this for T much, much smaller than 0.5 MeV. Okay, that's the electron mass. So this means that what is significant about this is that E plus E minus has become non-relativistic. So their contribution to entropy just goes to zero, right? It goes to zero exponentially, as we had seen. So we can use this formula, G1 effective SF lambda F cube. Equal to G2 effective S lambda cube. Okay, so lambda is any value of lambda for which temperature is much below 0.5. Okay. So what is G1 effective? G1 effective, sorry, not sorry, this I shouldn't say, let me, this TF cube. And this is TQ. Okay. So basically, I'm using the fact that SF, okay, up to this factor of 4/3 AB or 2/3 AB is proportional, is given by G times TQ. Okay. G is the effective number of degrees of freedom, right? Which, if you remember, is the number of bosonic states plus 7/8 times the number of fermionic states. Okay. So this is at the freeze out. And this is way below the electron positron mass, okay, where the electron positron contribution can be ignored. So you can easily calculate G1 effective and G2 effective. So G1 effective, okay, this gets contribution from E plus E minus and gamma. So gamma gives 2, okay, and E plus E minus gives 7/8 because those are fermions, okay, times 2 plus 2 because E plus gives 2. E minus gives 2, each has 2 polarization. So that's 7 by 2 times 2, that's 11 over 2. So this is 11 over 2. Okay. And this one gets contribution only from the photon. Okay. So this is 2. Is this clear? Are there questions? Let me write it properly here. So this is 2.
Sir, could you please explain calculation of G1 effective?
G1 effective, okay. So G1 effective, see, G1 effective is the value of effective G at the freeze out temperature, right? And at the freeze out temperature, okay, as you said, that the system is E plus E minus gamma. Okay. E plus and E minus can be regarded as relativistic because the temperature is above their masses. Gamma, of course, is massless, so it's relativistic. Okay. So we count the total number of degrees of freedom, okay, which, and for fermions, you have this extra factor of 7/8 that we saw, right? Because the entropy for the expression for the entropy has an additional factor of 7/8. Compared to bosons. So G1 effective gets contribution of 2 from the 2 photon states, right? 2 polarizations of the photon. And then you have 7/8, and then 2 from the 2 polarization states of the electron. Electron can be in spin up or spin down state. And 2 for the 2 polarization states of the positron, because each positron can also be in spin up and spin down state. So that gives you 7 by 2 plus 2, that's 11 over 2.
Okay, okay, sir.
Okay. And this is just getting contribution from the photon. Okay, that's why this is 2. So let me write this here. So this is, so this one is 2. Okay, so this tells us, let me write it here instead of going to the next page. This tells us that TF lambda F is equal to T times lambda times G2 effective is just 2, so 4 over 11. See, 11 over 2 divided by 2, okay, that's 11 over 4, and here you have the, okay, here you have G2 over G1, right? That's 2 divided by 11 over 2, so 4 over 11 to the power 1/3. So now you see the T nu, TF lambda F over lambda is T times this, right? TF lambda F over lambda, this is the thing that you need for calculating T nu. So T nu will be T times 4 over 11 to the power 1/3. Is this clear? So what this is saying is that the way below the e plus e minus the way below the 0.5 MeV temperature, where e plus e minus density has gone to almost zero, the neutrino temperature is smaller than the photon temperature by this factor. Now this happens not because the neutrino temperature doesn't follow 1/λ. In fact, neutrino temperature continues to follow 1/λ all the way till today. But this happens because the photon temperature doesn't quite follow the 1/λ. Because during this time, when the e plus e minus has become goes from relative being relativistic to non-relativistic, it transfers its temperature, transfers its entropy to the photon. So the photon temperature becomes larger than what we would have expected just from the 1/λ behavior. And that's why T nu becomes smaller than the photon temperature by this factor. And this continues till today. So this means that today, so this, the consequence of today. So today, T nu is 2.73 times 4/11 to the power 1/3. Is this clear? So this is one reason that you know that today the universe is filled with neutrinos with this temperature. Okay, they better be there because it's predicted, it's a consequence of the standard model, as long as our understanding of the cosmology is correct. Now here I should also add that this means that if we have massless neutrinos, for massless neutrinos, we have black body spectrum. At temperature T nu, for massive neutrinos, the distribution is more complicated, but we already derived it. But follows what we derived earlier. In particular, you saw that in terms of K, the distribution is thermal, okay, with some modified mass, okay, mass is scaled. But in terms of energy, the distribution is more complicated because the energy mass relation is different from what you might have expected from the thermal distribution. Okay. But in any case, the distribution is completely known, right? And you can calculate this.
Sir?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Now it does not matter that when temperature is decreasing, it will someday fall below the neutrino mass.
Yeah, it matters. It does matter. In fact, the neutrino mass is of the order of 0.1. Some of the neutrino masses, I think the upper bound is 0.1 electron volt. Right. So today, at least for some of the neutrinos, the temperature has fallen below that mass. And so that's why you have to use this more complicated distribution.
No, but what happens to it? It's entropy then. It does not get transferred to anything else, right?
Yeah. So because the neutrino is also out of thermal equilibrium, right? You can't even talk about its entropy. There's no entropy conservation for this system.
Also, like, do neutrinos interact with each other?
No, no. I mean, after that, you can ignore the neutrino interaction altogether. They interact by weak interaction, right? But as you saw, the typical collision of a neutrino with anything else will be less than 1 per Hubble time.
Okay.
Okay, so you can just think of them as free neutrinos.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other question? Okay. So now we turn to a different subject, although it will be the result that we just derived will be useful, will be necessary. So it turns out that this temperature range, the range 0.1 MeV to 1 MeV is important for another reason. And in fact, this is one of the most successful application of Big Bang cosmology. Okay, and basically we'll spend next few days discussing this. Okay. So let's recall that we have excess baryons, right? We have excess baryons. Okay. They do not affect the overall thermodynamics, right? Because their number is very small compared to the number of photons at that temperature and even today. Okay. But of course they are there. Okay. And while they do not affect the thermal properties of the background photons and electrons, the relativistic electrons, okay, the background of course affects them, right? Because each baryon has many, many collisions with the photons and electrons. Okay. So they can be thought of as in thermal equilibrium. So they are in thermal equilibrium. Thermal equilibrium. With the bath. At temperature T. And basically this temperature T you can take as a photon temperature. Because what happens is that when T is above the freeze out, neutrino freeze out temperature, okay, then of course the T and T nu are the same. Okay, and the baryons interact both with photons and neutrinos. Okay, they collide with both photons and neutrinos, okay, more than one collision per Hubble time. Okay. But once T falls below the freeze out temperature, okay, the interaction between baryons and neutrinos, okay, also go below the Hubble expansion rate, because this is also weak interaction, right? Baryon neutron interaction is also weak interaction. So below TF, T is the temperature of the bath, is the bath that the baryons fill. Above TF, it makes no difference whether we are using T nu or T. Okay, now you should also remember that at this stage, okay, at this temperature, at T of order MeV, baryon number is conserved. So NB lambda cube is conserved. Okay. But N to P transition is possible. Okay, so very, and it's possible by weak interaction. Maybe I should say here.
So, would you, what have you written in the range? Is it 1 MeV to 1 MeV?
0.1 to 1. This one? Okay. Yeah, roughly 0.1, say. Okay, a decade of temperature, right? Is that okay? I mean, is that what was that your question?
Yeah, I mean, and we are saying what in the down, like last statement, that
when T is larger than of order MeV, right, the baryon number is constant at this temperature. Okay. But NP transition is possible. Right? because neutrinos can neutron and protons can go into each other, right? There are weak interaction processes that can take neutron and proton to each other. Okay. Neutron, you know, decays, right? By in weak interaction process, neutron goes to P plus E minus plus nu bar. Right? And you can also reverse this, so N plus nu E to this. In a collision, N plus nu E can go to P plus E minus and so on. Okay, all of these processes are possible by weak interaction.
Okay.
So this TF is the TF of what?
The neutrino freeze out.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is neutrino freeze out. So TF for us will always be neutrino freeze out, at least for now. Okay. Or you can also say this is a weak interaction freeze out, right? Weak interaction stops being relevant after this temperature. Okay. So after this, you can pretend that anything that happens by weak interaction doesn't happen, right? So you just switch off the weak interaction altogether. And you write down only the QVD Lagrangian. Okay, so what I say is the NP transition is possible at this stage, right? Now let's see what else happens around this range. Okay, the precise details we'll be seeing later. Nuclear binding energy. Is of order MeV per nucleon. Okay, so nucleon means either proton or neutron. Okay. So we expect that for T less than MeV, the P and N will bind into nuclei. And what we'll see is that by studying this process carefully, we'll be able to predict the relative abundance of light elements. Okay. Which include hydrogen, of course, is just proton, right? Deuteron, helium 3, helium 4, lithium, and so on. Okay. And light elements, okay, because all the heavy elements, in fact, are formed much later. Heavy elements are formed in stars. Okay, so this will be our goal for the next few lectures. Okay, how to calculate the relative abundance of light elements. Are there questions? Okay, now I should just say that, I mean, I said something in the last slide, but I didn't explain the significance of this. Right? This, as I was saying, that this N to P transition is possible, right? Why is this relevant? For the next slide that I showed, right, N to P transition is possible, and now we are saying that we'll calculate the relative abundance of light elements. Okay. It should be clear that this relative abundance should be controlled by the N to P ratio, right? Okay. Imagine that we only had P and no N, then everything will be hydrogen, right? Because all other nuclei contains neutrons. So we need the P to N ratio, and that's non-trivial because the N to P transition is possible. Nobody has fixed it from the beginning. So you have to carefully keep track of the N to P, the relative abundance of N and P, and at the same time study the formation of light element or formation of nuclei, light nuclei, to determine the relative abundance of the light elements. Okay, so many things will go together in this analysis.
So could you repeat that?
Yes. So in the previous slide, I made a statement, right? The N to P transition is possible.
Yeah.
Now, why is this relevant, right? It's relevant because since N to P transition is possible, that means that the how much N we have relative to P has to be determined dynamically, right? It's not something that is fixed.
Okay.
And that information is crucial for determining this relative abundance of light elements. Okay. And I just gave an extreme example. Okay. That imagine that everything was P and there was no N. Then there'll be nothing to calculate, because if everything was P, then you would conclude immediately that everything would be hydrogen and there'd be no other element left, right? Because every other nuclei requires neutron.
Binding starts at below MeV, right?
Below MeV, yeah.
So by
that time, right? Roughly around MeV.
Yeah. So by that time, it has stopped P going to N and N going to P.
No. I'll explain why.
Okay. There is some overlap.
Okay, I can say. See that, okay. Naively, you think that, right? What you just said, that at P equal to 1 MeV, right? Because this weak interaction has frozen out, N to P transition has stopped, right? So at that time, the number of N and number of P ratio has already been fixed. The reason that that's not true is because N is not stable particle, right? Neutrons, this process is very much possible. The neutron energy, right, neutron mass is sufficiently large that it actually allows this process. So even after the weak interaction has fallen out of equilibrium, the N to P transition continues to take place. And this will play an important role. Is that
what? But the reverse one does not happen.
Reverse one probability goes down. And we'll have to do a detailed dynamical analysis, because this temperature is not very different from the formation temperature, right? But you're right that the dominant process will be this one.
Okay.
Yeah, but you will have to carefully make sure that the reverse one is small enough, right? And indeed, as I said, the most of the dominant contribution will come from this one. Okay, any other question? Okay, so what I'm going to do is to first give a broad overview of how we go about doing this calculation, okay. And then we'll turn to the details. Okay. And as I said, we'll take next few lectures to do these details. Okay, but let me just first give this broad overview. So the first point is that above TF or MeV, when N to P, or maybe I should just say that N plus stuff, this stuff includes electrons, neutrons, etc., P plus stuff, is in equilibrium, we expect the NN over NP ratio to be basically given by the Boltzmann factor. Okay. We'll have to do this calculation more carefully later after putting the chemical potential for the baryon number and so on. Okay. But roughly, we expect this to be e to the minus MN minus MP over T. Right? Because this is the energy of rest of neutron at rest. This is the energy of proton at rest. So we roughly expect this, and we can use the rest mass energy because the masses of neutrons and protons are of the order of the GeV, right? That's 1000 MeV. So these are really non-relativistic at this temperature. So you can just use this formula. And Mn minus Mp is of order of MeV. Okay, so Mn minus Mp, order MeV. Okay. So for T much larger than MeV, we expect that they are of the same order. Nn and Np are of the same order. Okay, that's where they start. Then for T less than MeV, as you saw, two things happen simultaneously. First of all, from this formula, we might expect that Nn over Np starts reducing. Right, it starts reducing because now Mn minus Mp is of order MeV, right? So this becomes an exponential suppression factor. So by this formula, T equal to 0.1 MeV, this ratio will be to the minus 10. Right? That's a tiny number. But at the same time, weak interaction falls out of equilibrium. So if these are both stable particles, if N and P are both stable particles, then you could say that roughly this ratio will get frozen at about one. Okay, maybe there will be a little less than one, but we can calculate it, okay, with some effort, and it should be of order one, and it will remain frozen there. But as we said, that it doesn't, the reason that it's not completely true is because the neutron is not stable. The reason that this number is not frozen is because N is not stable. So its number continues to deplete by this pk that we just wrote down, p plus e minus plus nu e bar. Okay. Even then, it's not completely clear at this stage that this process is relevant. Okay. Imagine that the neutron lifetime was of the order of years. Okay. In that case, even though this is allowed, maybe this will not be allowed, this will not be relevant, okay, by the time the temperature comes down to 0.1 MeV. Okay, because that's the time when the nucleosynthesis basically happens. Okay, so you have to see whether the neutron lifetime is on the right ballpark for this to be important. Okay. So the lifetime of a free neutron, okay, the half-life of a free neutron, is of the order of minutes, okay, maybe 13 minutes or something. That's of order 800 seconds. Okay. So you have to check, we need to compare this with the time scale that is involved as T varies between say MeV and 0.1 MeV. Is this clear? Okay. So this we'll do now, okay, just get an estimate. And of course, I mean, you know what to do, right? We'll basically use the Friedman equation, okay, to figure out what time scale is involved in going between MeV and 0.1 MeV. Okay, so here you want to get a rough estimate. Okay, so we ignore all factors of order one. So you have lambda dot over lambda squared. Key I'll ignore. 8 pi g over 3 times rho. And rho basically is like times t to the 4 times a constant, right? Some numerical constant, okay, which we'll not worry about right now. Okay. On the other hand, lambda is roughly of order 1 over t. Okay, even though we have seen that this is not quite true, okay, because e plus e minus becomes non-relativistic in this range, okay, but roughly it, you can still use it. Okay. So lambda dot over lambda square will replace by t dot over t square. This t dot over t square. This is of order. Let's ignore all numerical factors. So g times t to the 4. Okay. And now let's use natural unit g equal to 1. Okay. So this is just t to the 4. So this gives you t dot equal to, so t squared times t to the 4, that's t to the 6. So t dot is t cube. So 1 over t squared, so you just integrate 1 over t squared equal to t, okay, plus a constant, but that we'll just ignore. So t goes as t to the minus half. Is this clear? So you have arrived at this result, t is 1 over t square. Right? Now, we have to make sense of this, right? And we will make sense of this by noting that this everything has been done in natural units now, right? So you have said h bar equal to 1, c equal to 1, g equal to 1. So let's convert everything to natural units. So t is equal to 1 MeV, right? What does it mean in natural units? So this is 1 MeV. Over Planck, see, this is the unit of energy, so you convert it to Planck units, 10 to the 19 GeV. So that's 10 to the minus 22 in natural units, right? Is this clear? So you're basically writing 1 MeV in the Planck unit, okay, so that it becomes dimensionless. Because that's how, so this formula has to be interpreted that way, right? As a dimensionless formula. So you have to first convert t to dimensionless units. So this gives you t of order 10 to the minus 44. But what does it mean? Okay, now you have to convert it back to seconds, right? So t is 10 to the minus 44. T is the, has a dimension of time. So to convert it to seconds, you basically multiply it by t Planck. And t Planck, if you remember, okay, it was, I think, 5 times 10 to the 44 second or something. So you see that MeV means t of order 1 second, roughly. So this is for MeV, and because small t, the time goes as 1 over t squared. So t of order 100 second for t of order 0.1 MeV. Of course, one can do a much more refined calculation, right, by putting in the constants and so on. Okay, I'm not doing it, but I just wanted to give an idea that the time scale that is involved in going from, say, 0.1 MeV to 1 MeV to 0.1 MeV is of the order of 100 seconds. Okay. And that's the same order as a neutron lifetime, n lifetime. So this shows that you cannot ignore the end decay process, right? I mean, it's really important to take into account the decay of the neutron. Okay, so you cannot simply pretend that the weak interaction has fallen out of equilibrium, and hence we can just think of P and N as concept numbers. Is this clear? Okay, so the second part of the process is actually the bound state formation, right? So second part of the this nucleosynthesis analysis is the formation of bound state. Okay. And what complicates this process is that this is also a somewhat non-equilibrium process. Okay. If you just use the equilibrium formula, okay, for the formation for the bound state number of bound states compared to the free electrons and for free protons and neutrons, okay, the bound state formation would have occurred much earlier than where it actually happens. Okay. So here the situation is opposite, okay, namely that the at early time the system was out of equilibrium, okay, and it comes into equilibrium only at a later time. Okay. And this one we'll discuss in detail later. Okay, but basically what happens is that this is what is called the deuterium bottleneck. Okay, that helium is the most stable of the light nuclei in the sense that it has the maximum binding energy per nucleon. But the formation of helium, right? Helium has two neutrons and helium 4. Helium 4 has two neutrons and two protons. That doesn't happen very frequently because it requires two neutrons and two protons to come together. So the way actually bound state formation takes place is that it happens by first formation of deuterium, okay, which is one proton, one neutron, okay, because that has less binding energy, but the probability of one proton and one neutron coming together is certainly larger than two protons and two neutrons coming together. And once the deuterium forms, then it further collides with other things and the helium formation starts. So because of the low binding energy of the deuterium, okay, the formation of deuterium deuterium starts much later. And that's the reason why this system cannot be thought of as an equilibrium system. This whole process is an out of equilibrium process. So this again we'll study in detail later. But what happens? So what happens is that the beginning of the process requires some non-equilibrium analysis. So you cannot simply use the equilibrium density for the helium because of the large binding energy. Okay, the statistical factor will basically win out much earlier than when actually helium formation takes place. But once the formation starts, almost all neutrons get bound inside Hg. Very few remain in other light nuclei. Like D, Hg3, etc.
Sir?
Yes, go ahead, please.
If we want to write a process something like N plus P going to some bound state.
Yes.
I mean, how would we treat it? Like, it is not something like a QFT process, right?
Yeah, but we know nuclear reactions, right?
Do we know like the rate and rate of occurrence of such reactions or something like that?
Yeah. Certainly, I mean, the nuclear physics has been well studied, right? I mean, we knew about the rates of these before we knew the elementary particles, right? So dynamics of N and P, we certainly understand reasonably well, right? It's basically an electromagnetic process that will bind N and P together.
Is it like the collision processes we have in QFT? Yeah,
not just electromagnetic, there's also strong interaction.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's not, so it's captured, right? So it's a dense soup of N and P. right? Well, not so dense maybe, but still reasonably dense soup of N and P. So it's captured, and we will calculate in detail, right, how to study these processes.
Back in quantum mechanics, we somewhat at times use an imaginary potential to indicate that there is some sort of a particle capture.
Yes.
Is that what happens in this nucleus sort of?
Well, there are various ways to do that, right? I think we'll probably not use the imaginary potential form, but we'll see how to do this estimate.
Okay,
but it's a well-defined process, right? And I mean, as I said, nuclear physics is well understood, so that you can take the current lab experiments and get information about how this capture will take place, right? The only thing we cannot probably reproduce in the current lab is the appropriate density of neutrons and protons and that temperature. But from low energy experiment, we can figure out what would happen in that setup. Okay. But we'll see, surprisingly, that many of the details are not important. Okay. Because once the bound state formation starts, then again, one can use equilibrium statistical mechanics formula. Okay, but again, this I'll try to explain later.
Also, one thing, like maybe not related to this, but generally, like the proton's mass is not due to the proton itself, right? It's in the sense that it's the binding energy of the quarks.
Yes.
So, like when like at very high temperatures, like let's say above 1000 GeV or something, those quarks were independent?
Yes, so that time it was a quark gluon soup. Right?
So when they actually came into this bound state proton, these were still relativistic. Like the quarks would have been relativistic.
Yeah, while relativistic, yes. But they are confined, they are strongly interacting, right?
Yeah. I'm just saying that I don't think there are other examples of relativistically binding particles or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, the point is, it's not even clear that one should call it binding in the sense that the quarks are confined, so they are never unbound. Right? I mean, the closest to unbound that you can go and get to is that at very high temperature, it goes into this quark gluon plasma phase, right? Where you can think of this as free quarks and gluons moving together. But that doesn't mean that you can actually separate a quark from the rest.
They are still localized.
Yeah, it just behaves like a free gas of quarks and gluons. Okay, if not free gas, maybe weakly interacting gas of quarks and gluons. But it's not, there is no free quark, right? There is no separate free quark, right? You cannot isolate one quark from the rest.
So can two protons exchange their quarks if brought close enough?
Yeah, nuclear reaction you can think of as something like that, because after all, the quarks are indistinguishable. So it's not clear what one means by exchanging quarks. Okay. But if you are thinking of a quark getting converted to different type of quark, right?
Yeah.
That happens by weak interaction. So strong interaction cannot change the type of quark.
Okay.
Right. So the heavy baryons, right? They are unstable and they decay by weak interaction of this kind, where the quark changes its nature.
All right.
See, the neutron decay, for example, right, is of that kind, right? A quark inside a neutron has changed its flavor, right? Because proton is UUD and neutron is UDD. Okay, so one up quark has gotten changed to a down quark. And yeah, that's so a weak interaction process.
Decay is a weak interaction process, right?
Yes, that's right. So that is neutron decay is a weak interaction process. Yeah, there can be electromagnetic decay also, but neutron decay certainly is a weak interaction process. Okay. And one rule is that anything that involves neutrinos, right, is weak interaction, because neutrinos do not take part in either strong or weak electromagnetic interaction.
Yeah.
Any other question? Okay. So this fact, right, tells us, gives a very simple formula, this fact tells us that if you want to know the ratio of neutron to proton today, this will be given because all the neutrons got bound inside helium, right? And then the leftover protons, right, have to remain as hydrogen, right? Because leftover protons cannot go do anything else. So this is given by then 2 times the number of helium nuclei. Helium here refers to He4, the number of He4 divided by 2 times NH4 plus NP, NH. Okay, NH is the same as NP. Is this formula clear? See, each helium 4 contains 2 neutrons, right? That's why it is 2 times the number of helium 4 nuclei. And each helium 4 contains 2 protons. And each hydrogen contains 1 proton. So that's why it's 2 times NH4 plus NH. And here I am ignoring the contribution from the other light nuclei because they are very few in numbers. So this is the number of neutrons, the neutron to proton ratio, okay, in terms of the helium to hydrogen ratio. Okay. But of course, the way to use it is to do the reverse, right? Using this, we can calculate NHE over NH. And that is given by, I think, NN over 2 times NP minus NN. Okay, you should check this formula carefully. Okay. And this means that if we know NN to NP at the time of formation, time of bound state formation, then we know NH4 over NH. Is this clear? So this is the procedure we are going to follow, right? We'll basically try to, so what we need to do is to identify, okay, when the bound state formation starts taking place. Okay. And as I said, that basically happens when this dotterial bottleneck is removed. Okay. That first you have to form the dotteron, okay, and that's the main bottleneck. Once that is removed, okay, then more or less the bound states, all bound states form immediately. Okay, because it's a fast process. And so you have to identify the time at which this bottleneck is removed. And at that time, you have to estimate the ratio of the neutron to proton ratio. Is this clear?
Sir, isn't hydrogen also more stable than deuterium?
Yes, it is.
So when the deuterium is being formed,
yes,
at the same time, at that time also hydrogen is being formed.
See, hydrogen is always there, right? Hydrogen here means proton because electrons are not bound to protons anyway, right?
Oh, yeah.
That we're only talking about the nucleus. So hydrogen, of course, is very much there, right? Hydrogen and neutrons. And the point is that to form helium, you have to first put hydrogen and neutron together to make a deuteron.
Yeah.
And so that's the bottleneck.
But eventual formation is of both the hydrogen atom and helium atom is happening at 10 to the minus 3, lambda of 10 to the minus 3.
Yeah. So that's much lower, right? That's temperature of order of electron volts.
Yeah.
Right? Here you're talking about billion electron volts. But once the nuclear ratios are fixed, right? That doesn't change anymore, right? The electron capture process is not going to change the nuclei into some other nuclei. To calculate the helium to hydrogen ratio, right, you have to basically look at that 1 MeV scale. Because once that they are formed, that gets frozen.
Yeah. Yeah, and also lastly, like if we were to just add another atom, let's say lithium.
Yes.
Like we'll have three unknowns then, and.
Yeah, yeah. So we'll have to ultimately we'll solve everything, right? We'll show how to calculate all of these. Okay. And the reason that it's possible to do this calculation without going to detailed numerical analysis, of course, finally you have to, if you want a precise result, you should do numerics. Okay. But the point is that once the Reuterium bottleneck is removed, right, then you can use the thermal ensemble results, right? Then the relative abundances can be given just by the statistical mechanics. And that's the way we will estimate these numbers.
Based on the bound state energies of these?
Exactly, based on the bound state energies of these. Right? And the reason that the helium-4 dominates is because it has the maximum binding energy per nucleon.
All right.
Okay, any other question?
You said at the time, this helium-4 are formed, won't helium-3 will also be formed? I mean, because I don't know if this process makes helium-3, but deuteron has to combine with one more proton.
Yeah, exactly. So helium-3 will also be formed. So everything forms together. Once the deuteron bottleneck is removed, right, then the interactions are so fast that basically everything is formed, and you can use the thermal equilibrium formula to determine the relative abundances.
But then this ratio won't hold, right?
No, it will hold if it's thermal equilibrium, right? You are saying, yeah, so there will be some extra contribution here. So this is not an exact result.
Okay.
But the point is that because the helium is the dominant part, right? Helium and hydrogen are the dominant contributions. Because the helium binding energy is the maximum.
Helium-4. Okay.
That's why, I mean, to first approximation, you can ignore everything else. To calculate the helium to hydrogen ratio. And then these numbers are small corrections. So you basically calculate their number related to hydrogen or helium.
Okay.
Any other question? Okay. So now I'm going to start with the details. Okay. And as I said, this I'm not going to finish today. I'll just do one part of this calculation, okay, which will not have anything to do with the bound state formation. So the step one is that we need to find time dependence of T and T nu. Now, why T and T nu? T, of course, should be clear because T is the temperature that provides the bath. Okay, so this when you apply thermodynamics, this is the temperature we are going to use. Okay. T nu is important because this determines the number of ambient neutrinos, nu and nu bar. And the reason that this is important is because this affects N to P transition rate. How it happens, we'll see later, but I can just give a naive explanation, which is that we know how to calculate the decay rate of free neutron, right? Neutron in vacuum. But when neutron is immersed in a bath of nu and nu bar, then what's going to happen? So neutron is supposed to decay into nu bar E and proton, right? But if there's a bath of nu and nu bar, then some of the nu bar states, which the neutron would have decayed to in a vacuum, may be occupied. And that will suppress the decay. On the other hand, if there's ambient nu, then ambient nu can combine with neutron. And give P plus E minus. So the reason, so because of this reason, we need to keep track of what are the ambient nu and uR density. And that's controlled by T nu. Okay, so that's why both T and T nu are important in determining the subsequent evolution of this PN system. Now the steps for determining these are clear, right? I have already said. So let me give the steps and then I'll give some of the details, okay? Right, I'm gonna set up the detailed equations. So steps for determining T and T nu. The first step is that use S lambda cube equal to constant to find T lambda relation. Right, because S depends on T. So this S refers to E plus E minus gamma system. So S refers to T, so we can determine the T lambda relation from there. Then you use this T nu equal to TF lambda F over lambda to determine, to find T nu lambda relation. And then finally, we use the Friedmann equation, lambda root over lambda squared equal to 8 pi g by 3 rho, right? So rho here will be from the E plus E minus gamma system plus the nu system. So this is determined in terms of T. This is determined in terms of T nu. Okay, each of which have been determined in terms of lambda. So we use this to determine lambda as function of T. And then using 1 and 2 gives you T and T nu as function of T. It's function of T. Okay, so that will be the procedure we'll be following. Okay. Except that we'll change the details a little bit. Okay. Because as you will see that we don't really need the lambda information very much. So what you are going to do is that we'll basically write the equation for T directly instead of writing the equation for lambda. But this is, these are the three ingredients that we have to use. So let me explain how this is done. So step one. So S E plus E minus gamma, let's write the expression for that. So this is, so first write the gamma, okay? 2/3 AB T cube times two, this two comes from the G of gamma, right? Gamma has two polarization states, so it's 2/3 AB T cube times two, plus the entropy of the E plus E minus system. Okay? So that's given by this P E plus E minus plus P, sorry, plus rho E plus E minus over T. So let's continue. So this is 4/3 AB T cube plus 1/T times 1/2 pi square. I'm not going to write down the full expression, times E plus E minus, has, I'm doing the E plus and E minus together because mu is zero anyway. So 2 plus 2. So 2 from E plus, 2 from E minus. So 2 from E minus and 2 from E plus. This 2 is from gamma. And then we have integral from 0 to infinity, k squared dk. And now I'm going to write down the expression for P and rho both. So the expression for P, this is a fermionic state, right? So 1 plus e to the minus square root of k square plus m square over T plus the expression for rho, is square root of k square plus m square. Sorry, this is the expression for p times. Sorry, let me erase this. Okay, because this is already p by t, right? Because p by t is log 1 over p log q, and so this involves p over t. So I don't include this p t here. I include a t here because rho. Okay, the expression for rho is what I'm going to write now. Is this clear?